Heavenly Father, most gracious and high God, Lord, we thank you for allowing us to gather together and worship you. We thank you, Lord, for being our God. We thank you for supplying Christ as a ransom and a sacrifice for our sins. Lord, we know that he rose again and that he sits at your right hand and that you've given him authority over everything. We know that he intercedes for us daily with you for our sins. Lord, we beg that you forgive us. You are our God, Lord. Thank you for being our God. Go with us this morning. Teach each and every one of us something that we can use to spread the truth and hope of your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. I had planned on doing a whole visual aid thing this morning, but I left my visual aid at home, so y'all are just going to have to wait, and we will do that Wednesday. We are still stuck on the armor of God, which is in Ephesians chapter 6. I hope y'all don't get bored easy. But we're just going to touch on this, and then we're going to jump over to something that's going to seem at first completely different. We're Ephesians chapter 6. Same thing we went over in Sunday school for those of you who are here. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against powers, and against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your loins, not waist, with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. And that's where we're going to stop. The big thing to remember is when you're talking about the armor of God, is that the first thing the scriptures tell us to do is to gird our loins. It doesn't tell us to put our belt on first. There's no accident in the scriptures. It's saying to put on or to gird our loins first. That means this is the most important thing. It says to put on the protection, the core, the truth. We have to know the truth. If we don't know what the truth is, we can't put it on. Where are we going to find the truth? The truth is found in the Bible. The scriptures. All the way from the Old Testament through the New Testament. You are going to find truth in Genesis. You're going to find truth in Job. You're going to find truth in Revelations. But it has to be the truth. Science says that a bumblebee cannot fly. The truth is, God says the bumblebee flies just fine. We will never be able to prove scientifically everything that God can make happen. But the truth is, God can make anything happen, and God does make everything happen. The The truth of the matter is, God exists in three parts. There is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. You have to have all of them to have any of them. You cannot know the Son without knowing the Father. You cannot know the Father without knowing the Son. And you cannot have the Holy Spirit without having the Son and the Father. I know I've said that before, and if I get a chance, I'm going to say it every Sunday, every Wednesday, every Saturday, every Friday. I'm going to say it to everybody I run into, because that is the truth. The truth is that what we call the Old Testament, the Torah and the prophets, the law and the prophets, is the basis for Christianity, or what we call Christianity. I don't mind being called a Christian. It was originally designed as a slur by the Romans and the Jews and stuff for the people who had decided to follow Christ. But here's the thing. If you follow Christ, you will be persecuted. The world will not want to have anything to do with you. Or not anything you want done anyway. I hate to say this, but if everything is peaches and cream, daisies and butterflies, unicorns and rainbows in your world, you need to be real careful about who you're worshiping. There's something a lot of people, and we're not going to have time to get to it, but it's in these little notes that I have here. While all authority and power resides with God the Father and is under the control of Christ, it does not change the fact that they, in agreement, gave earth to Satan. And he is literally the ruler of this world until Christ comes back. The reason Satan tried so hard to get Jesus to fail was that if he could have talked him out of it somehow, if he could have got him to plead with his Father to get him off the cross before he died, if in the garden God had of give in to his Son's earnest prayer that the cup be taken from him, then Satan's reign would have been forever. That was when Satan was fighting to win. Now Satan is just fighting to take as many of us to hell with him as he can. He knows that his days are numbered. He knows that he cannot win the jewel, which is called earth, as his kingdom, as his reign forever. He knows that he is done. The only fight that he has left is to steal just as many souls to hell as he can. That sounds kind of Catholic. But you know, we do kind of share the same God, even though we're a little lost. I don't have anything against Catholic. I don't have anything against Jews. I don't have anything against all the different Anabaptists. If you are preaching Christ and his salvation and earnestly trying to follow the truth of the word, then you are not my enemy. You are at the very least trying to be a brother or a sister to me. And that's the way we all need to think. I have had Bible study with Catholics before. And they're, I don't know about the priests, but your average Joes, their understanding of the Bible is really not that far off from ours. they have some differences, and we all know that, and so. But they got their idols, we have ours. Right now I have on a Star Wars t-shirt under here. Just saying, I like Star Wars. I try not to make it an idol, but I spent money on the shirt. You know, I pay $8 for this one or $5 for the same color shirt with nothing on it. Would have made more sense to get the plain shirt, but I spent the money on Star Wars. Now I lost them for 2 months. That's very annoying. I didn't look at it, I didn't lose them. I put them in my closet, and I forgot to put them in my closet. But I found them. I wore one last week, and I wore one today. And now I'm going to wear them out. Here's a little bit of truth. When it all hits, and it will, there's some things we need to be aware of. Satan is trying to bring about the tribulation, because that's when he's going to get most of his people. Granted, a lot of people run to church when things get bad, but they're not running to God, they're running to church. And that's not what we want to do. We want to run to God. We want God to be on our side. Because if God is not with us, anything will be able to stand against us. That's the complete opposite of what the scripture says, because it's true. The scripture says, if God is with us, what can stand against us? Nothing. It's not because we're super tough or super bad or God's made us something more than we aren't. It's the simple fact that God's right there and nothing's going to get past him. That's just the way that is. Matthew chapter 24, verse 17. And there's too many of them to try to keep up with me. I'm going to go to them and we'll read them real quick. Jot them down or you can ask me for them later. 24:17. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. And then Mark 13. I should have, if I could have found my Bible. If anybody sees a Bible in a cloth case that's got coffee stains and Jesus sketched on the back of it, give me a call. Mark chapter 13. Let him who is in the housetop not go down into the house, nor enter to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. And you can go on and on and on and on. And for time's sake, I'm not going to touch on all those. I'm going to jump over to Revelation real quick. It boils down to is the Bible is the truth. The word in here is the truth. It comes from God. Over and over and over again in this book, it tells us to be ready to run for our lives from something. So the truth of one of the truths that we need to face is that our enemy is alive, he is active, and he is seeking to destroy us. So we have to be ready to do what the book says. If we don't know what the book says, we can't do it. Yeah. Things, everybody wants to gripe about how bad things are right now. Dave, I'm jumping around really fast, so I'll give you a list of the scriptures after, and you can look them up if you want to, all right? But in this one's out of Revelation chapter 9, verse 6. As bad as anybody thinks it is today, and if you can't really find a timeline, I know lots of people have tried to describe a timeline in Revelations, but I'm not going to go there yet, but we will. Here is a little window into what it's going to be like in the days of tribulation, or the days leading up to tribulation and during tribulation. In those days, men will seek death and will not find it. They will desire to die, and death will flee from them. Things will get so bad that men will literally, men, women, people, will want it to end. And the powers in control will have rigged it to where you cannot die. Slit your wrist. Does you no good. I don't know how they're going to do it. I don't care. But when your mind and your spirit are so torn and so anguished that you seek the release of suicide and it will not, you can't even get that, and they've taken that away from you, that's how bad it's going to get. I do not, shall not, will not, refuse to, because it is not in this book, believe in the rapture. There may and may not be people that are caught up before, during, whatever. And let me clarify, pre-tribulation or whatever rapture. It's not in the book. It's a very vague passage that doesn't tie to anything. I don't believe in the rapture. It's not there. Don't expect me to come up here and teach y'all warm, fuzzy things about the fact that when things get really bad, God is going to just suck you off this planet and you don't have to go through it, because that is not the way it's written. It is written in there that things will get so bad that even the very elect might choose, they don't, but it is very possible that they could have chose to back out of the Jesus deal. That's how bad it's going to get. And if the elect are still here, what makes me think I got sucked up? If the elect are still here, suffering through it all, risking it all, being confused and tricked and lied to, what makes us think that we're going to get out of that? We're not getting out of it. We got to ride this train all the way to the end. We have to be ready to give everything up. We see it coming. We don't run back into our house and grab our photo albums, our favorite jacket, the keys to our motorboat. When God comes back, whatever we have on us, in us, it's the only thing that's going to matter. And there's going to be another sermon on this. If it doesn't keep falling apart, there will be another sermon on that. Because there are things we can do to make sure that, or not make sure, make sure is a very strong word. There are things we can do as a church, as brothers, as sisters, to make it a lot easier to deal with the tribulation, which I really hope is 3.5 years and not 35 or 350 or whatever it could be. Because it's talking about, a day is like 1,000 years and all that. We worship a God that exists outside of time. He's the only deity that's able to do that, because time doesn't apply to him. He's quite simply still creating earth at the same time that he's listening to me butcher this sermon. The power of God, it drives me nuts to the way I feel, the warm, the love, everything I can feel within me when I think about the power of God. And that something that strong would be willing to put a piece of himself into the fleshly body of a human and experience all the beauty and warmth of the good side of being a human. Just to have him go to the cross and die for all the things he never did for me and for y'all. How great they are? I can't do it. And when I think that God, not sparing, sent his son to die for me, I scarce can take it in. I just can't wrap my head around it. I don't know about y'all, but a God that loves me that much, I guess he's entitled to do whatever he wants to do, because I am his creation. We are all his creation, whether we choose to follow him or not. I was following a preacher around one day in town. We were going somewhere, and then I noticed that he had him a new bumper sticker. His bumper sticker read very plainly, "It's okay if you choose not to believe in God. One day you will." And there was a little cross and a grave. It was pretty to the point. You got two choices. You can believe in him while you're alive and go to heaven, or you can wait until you die and find out you were wrong, and then it's a little too late. I know all y'all we're not going to have an invitation. I don't think there's any heathens out there. We're going to go ahead and pray and dismiss and beat everybody to the catfish. Okay. Heavenly Father, most gracious and high God, Lord, again, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this building you've given us to worship in. Lord, we pray that you would give us more people to reach. Put people in our path, Lord, that we can minister to. Lord, I'm going to lift up Dave to you. Lord, this man is precious beyond belief to me. I ask that you give him strength. I ask that you keep him whole. And Lord, I pray, I beg, I plead that you let me keep him a while. Again, Lord, it's all about you, not about us. So whatever you want it to be, let it be. We praise you in all your power. And we give you all the glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.